again. If everyone could please find a seat. As soon as you all sit down, we'll stand up and let the allegiance and invocation.
We are gathered together in the meeting place for the betterment of the city, the residents, and council members. May God enrich our lives with his knowledge.
Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Madam Clerk, I believe we're all here, but would you call the roll to make sure?
Kramer?
Here.
Farmer?
Here.
Gilbert?
Here.
Hicks?
Here.
Krieger?
Here.
Haston?
Here.
Root? Here.
Yes, we are all here. Very good. First item on our agenda this evening is the motion to approve the minutes of our last meeting on July 22. Mr. Root, would you please read that motion?
I move the Schwartz Creek City Council approve the minutes of the regular council meeting held Monday, July 22, 2019, to be circulated and placed on file.
Second.
Motion's made and seconded. Are there any additions or corrections to be made to the minutes? I have one. Page 33. Resolution 05, whereas number 4.
The commercial lease?
It's says retails on the first line toward the end. Third word from the end should be retail, I believe. Without the S. And that's all I have. No one else is asking for the floor with any additions or corrections, so would you please call the roll?
Farmer?
Yes.
Gilbert?
Yes.
Hicks?
Yes.
Krieger?
Yes.
Haston?
Yes.
Root?
Yes.
Kramer?
Yes.
The motion passes. Next item of the business that we have this evening is to approve the agenda for tonight. Mr. Little, are there any changes to the agenda that you have?
No.
No changes. Mr. Kramer, would you read the motion, please?
Absolutely. I move the Schwartz Creek City Council approve the agenda as printed for the regular council meeting of August 12, 2019, to be circulated and placed on file.
Second.
Motion made and seconded. Are you speaking of the motion? Anybody on the council have something to add to the agenda? No, we don't. So, Madam Clerk, would you call the roll?
Gilbert?
Yes.
Hicks?
Yes.
Krieger?
Yes.
Haston?
Yes.
Root?
Yes.
Kramer?
Yes.
Farmer?
Yes.
Motion passes. Next item on the agenda is the city manager's report. Anything to add, Mr. Zell?
No, Your Honor.
Motion to accept the city manager's report.
I move the Schwartz Creek City Council accept the city manager's report of August 12, 2019, including reports and communications, to be circulated and placed on file.
Second.
Motion's made and seconded. Are there any questions or any comments on anything in the city manager's report? No, there aren't. Madam Clerk, we're ready to vote.
Hicks?
Yes.
Krieger?
Yes.
Haston?
Yes.
Root?
Yes.
Kramer?
Yes.
Farmer?
Yes.
Gilbert?
Yes.
The motion passes. We have quite a number of other communications and reports in the packet. Are there any questions on anything or comments on anything that's going to come up that won't be part of our business this evening?
Yes.
Okay, Mr. Kramer.
Yes. I was just wondering, I'm just curious. I know we have something on our agenda, reference for purchase coming up here, but how is the condition of our DPW wood chipper?
The wood chipping truck is in a great state of disrepair. The chipper, as far as I know, is adequate.
Oh. Okay. I was just curious what type of condition it's in. We need to look at it as a time for replacement. Is it still good? I didn't know.
We intend to have a more complete asset management plan or fleet maintenance plan within the next 12 months. There's nothing remarkable about that asset at this point in time.
Oh.
I have been assigned a...
That's the question I have.
All right.
Thank you.
You're welcome. I just have a general comment. I see in there that there was a bill paid for the flowers that are in our city, and just want to comment, those flowers are gorgeous. And driving around the several cities, we have the best looking flowers in our city or any place I've seen. So the ladies did an excellent job, and for those that helped pay for that, thank you. And Chief Bailey, I believe you have something to announce about an open house coming up.
I do, Mayor. We have an open house, our second annual, next Wednesday, the 21st, from 6 p.m. to 8 p.m. And I hope all of you are able to attend and encourage your neighbors and friends. Spread the word. We'd love to have you. Bring kids. They can get into police cars, tour the building, talk to the officers, detectives, see K-9. Just basically, we're opening it up to everybody. So please join us. We'll have hot dogs, too, if they like hot dogs.
And where is that open house going to be, Chief Bailey?
Metro Police Headquarters, 5420 Hill 23 Drive.
And that is right next door to?
Myers.
Myers store.
Yes.
Thank you.
And one more question.
Yes, sir.
Oh, Gilbert. What time did you say that was?
6 to 8. I'm sorry?
The date and the time.
The 21st, next Wednesday. 6 p. to 8 p.
Thank you.
You bet.
Hope you can all join us there. Anything else? Yes, Mr. Kramer.
Yeah, I had a question. going over the city council packet, I noticed there was a problem with the soil in some of the streets. Should we talk about that later on in the meeting, or? But what's going on with the soil?
No, it's definitely something we'll have to discuss. We're going to debrief our Helmsley project shortly.
Okay.
Bobby, do you have any comment on that at this point, or is it not yet prepared?
No, not yet at this point.
Okay. The short of it is there's a lot more undrained clay underneath the base of Helmsley than was anticipated, even with the samples that were taken. And it's been difficult to lay a base on that we feel is going to have the longevity that the design is supposed to deliver. It wasn't as readily apparent with the prior streets that were demolished because they had a lot of concrete with concrete pumped bases. Repairs that were done in the 70s where you drill holes and pump in more concrete to stabilize it. So Helmsley had to have some additional work put into it, some quantities of gravel and some additional labor to reevaluate and establish a base in a couple of locations. The point is we may have to take a closer look at our specifications for select streets moving forward to ensure we're going to be handling the subsoils appropriately. We do want to get a 50-year street,
yes,
or so out of these, and if we can't get a good base, and nothing else is going to last.
Okay.
So we We do feel like we're going to get a good product here, but we may want to spend some time evaluating the soils and our application for future projects. We'll have more, of course, as we get into fall and winter.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And you may recall what we got into fixing the streets. We asked the citizens who were here, ask us to do this. He wanted us to do it cheaper, he wanted to do it right. And they also do it right. So that's the point.
Yes, absolutely.
All right. Anything else from the council? Then we shall open the meeting to the public for your general comments. Anybody have any comments for the council tonight?
I just wanted to update the council.
Who are you again?
Yeah, Dave. Eric James. Whatever address you want. I just wanted to update the council on the Back to the Bricks art group that we had. Tremendous turnout. Went very well. This was just a refresh of everyone's memory. We were splitting the day between another community or another city, and the Back to the Bricks decided to give us a full entire day this year and go with the people that, I guess, showed the most initiative for the event. And it turned out great. We had an absolutely just outstanding event. Tons of cars. They're working on the exact numbers now, but they're saying almost probably double what we had last year. So it was great. If you were down there, if you drove through the west end of town, you saw them stretch from the church next to the tree barn all the way down through the vacant lot at Seymour and Miller on the south side. It was a great show. We fully intend to show off our new downtown next year, so look for some information from the town. We're planning for that. We'd like to move the show downtown, like the rest of the communities do that are part of the Back to the Bricks. Our show, one of the biggest in the nation now. We'd like to be able to move it downtown. Now we'll have the proper facilities in downtown, like the rest of the communities do. But overall, it was great.
Did you run out of stuff?
What's that?
Did you completely run out of stuff there that day?
No, we this is our third year of it, so we knew we were able to plan ahead. But we planned a little different this year because of the changes, the formatting changes. But it was great. I thought it was great. Chief Bates sent a patrol car for community outreach, which was much appreciated. The fire department sent an engine when we called the firefighters. It's a great community event. I love it. I hope we can keep the support of the city.
Thank you. Just a reminder for everyone that's here, the reason that we ask you to state your name and address before you start giving your comments is that we're recording the session and we have clerical staff who transcribes it into minutes, but they're not here to see who's talking. So because they're not here to see you, unless you tell them who you are before you start talking, they don't know that. Anyone else? No one else wishes to address the council, and then we'll get into our business and hopefully get through that tonight before 10 or 11 o'clock. And the first, I was going to say that we don't expect there to be too much business tonight that's controversial, except for the first thing on the agenda, which seems to be the modular big B site plan. So everybody have copies of that?
Actually,
I gave you. Well, I brought two. I believe that usually what we do is have a resolution to accept it, and after that we discuss it. So I will start with the resolution, and then we can open discussion. And next, we can read the resolution.
Whereas the city received a proposal to construct a drive-through use on the Meyer site identified as parcel 58-36-100-014, said land zoned General Business District, GBD, with the planned unit development overlay zoning classification, and whereas the project is a special land use within the GBD and requires site plan review with an additional approval for the special land use, and whereas the Planning Commission found that the project consisting of a drive-through only modular structure to be an innovative land use that is best classified as an accessory use, and whereas the Planning Commission, in reviewing the application materials and review criteria in zoning ordinance, found the proposed site plan of a special land use for drive-through to meet the intent of the zoning ordinance, and whereas the Planning Commission found that the site plan, in conjunction with the special land use, met all other general standards applicable for the site plan and special land use, with the following exceptions: drive spacing is not dimensioned, drives do not contain curb, landscaping plan is incomplete, site plan informational data, while generally sufficient for review, is incomplete, proposed lighting may produce glare, building materials are non-durable. Whereas the Planning Commission, in further reviewing the ordinance, found that the plan, while not in strict compliance with the specific ordinance requirements for a special land use, found such special land use requirements to be unnecessary or irrelevant in accordance with zoning section pertaining to special land uses, including requirement for a traffic study, requirement for 3 drive-through delivery spaces. Whereas the engineering reviews are not yet available as it relates to utilities, stormwater materials, and related stormwater materials and related features, and whereas the Planning Commission approved the site plan and recommended approval of the special land use with conditions at the regular meeting on August 6, 2019. Now be resolved that the Swartz Creek City Council hereby approves the special land use and related site plan dated 7/19/2019, including the City Council packet of August 12, 2019, subject to the following conditions, as well as any recommendations of the city engineers: landscaping to be revised and administratively approved, lighting to be affirmed to be non-glare, building material, color, and roof provisions to be waived, site plan to be updated to affirm dimensions, standard requirements, requirement for curbing to be waived, all other engineering standards shall be applied to site development, waiver of a traffic study, and waiver of provision of 3 drive-through delivery spaces.
Second.
Motion has been made and seconded. Now, we have a presentation first, Mr. Zettel, or would you like to speak to this?
Just procedurally, what the council's resolution boils down to is the special land use drive, which the site plan hinges upon. Site plans are under the purview of the Planning Commission exclusively. Special land uses come before council. In this case, of course, the entire site plan hinges upon special land use since it is a drive-through facility. So that's what it's here for at this point in time, and the council has those special land use specific requirements to review, as well as the general expectations that are listed there. I did include, of course, the application, the plans, the review letter from CIB Planning. The planner that drafted that letter is present this evening and can answer questions if people have those. Otherwise, I will look to turn it over to the applicant petitioner for them to be able to describe the concept, what it is they're doing, and then how they're applying it in Swartz Creek. Then, of course, I'd be available for questions regarding the Planning Commission process and how we got here, the site in general.
Very good. Okay, who wants to speak on behalf of the petition?
I'll go ahead and speak, please.
All right. So tell us who you are so that the secretary knows.
My name is Adam Atkinson. Do you want my address? It's 12011 Miller Road. That's in Atlanta, Michigan, 44449. I just would like to, last time I didn't get it with the Planning Commission, I didn't get a chance to really explain the concept. And I think some of our photos visually were outdated. And I wanted to also show you guys some pictures of the most recent Big B Coffee BQ that was developed and show you photos of the finished product of it. But real quick, I'll just, my name is Adam Atkinson. I'm going to be one of the owner operators of the Big B Coffee BQ. With me is Jeff Konchak. He is the developer. He created the idea, came up with the design and everything about it, and got it approved through Big B Coffee. My wife, Megan Atkinson, who runs currently our three other stores. My daughter, Emery, who's just a cheerleader. And my father, who will also be co-owner of the store, which is Dan Atkinson. Currently, we have three baby coffees, one in Flint Township that we opened 7 years ago, one in Clyde, Michigan that we opened up a year and a half ago, and one in Berkeley that we recently just took over. What got us into it was the idea and the model behind Creepy Coffee, which is to love people and to create a phenomenal business that is very community-oriented. With our Flint Township store, as well as our Clyde and our Burton stores, we are members of the Chamber, and anytime we are asked to donate, anytime there's a parade, we participate. And when the opportunity became available to us to open up a big coffee in Swords Creek, which is in our backyard, we jumped all over the idea. This has been something we've been wanting to do for a while, and the concept of this modular unit is just so awesome. We couldn't help but jump right on top of it. Just to give a little bit about the design, it's basically 350 square feet, the modular unit itself. It comes with the actual unit and then a tower that stands about 18 feet tall and a canopy that covers the vehicles coming through the lot. When they combine together, although very small, it has a pretty cool looking appearance, and I think adds to the outlook of what the city wants. The current place we're looking to go in is an unused space that they had no future plans to do anything on. It's the directly where we plan to develop it is directly south of the Meijer gas station, in between the Meijer gas station and entry point to Meijer. This space had no purpose before, and now we have the opportunity to bring in a pretty cool concept that will also assist with bringing in additional businesses, and it'll bring in jobs and also more people and money to the city. I think what I'd like to do right now is just pass out the photos. This is the Big B Coffee that was recently opened in Saugatuck. And the top photo that I'm going to present to you guys is pass around shows the unfinished product that we presented at the Planning Commission. And then the photo two, the second photo and the other one show finished product and what it looks like. So I'm just going to pass that as I explain to how we are going to be different from this one. So the first photo, it shows the pillars that are underneath it. What we plan on doing is very similar to that second photo where we will wrap the unit with a curve so it doesn't look like it's a modular unit whatsoever. It looks like it's a permanently placed unit. With the drive-through that we have planned in the already existing grass combined with the vegetation that we plan, the landscaping we plan on doing, we think that this is going to be just an awesome looking store and that people are going to, it's going to be something that you're going to be proud of. And on top of it, it allows us an opportunity to get back into our community involvement and be more involved with Swords Creek. Besides that, if you guys have any more questions, I also have Jeff here, who's an expert on the engineering part of this and also how it works. So.
Questions from anyone? Yes, ma'am.
As you can see, these plants are rather dog-eared. So I spent a lot of time going through this, and so I have lots of questions.
Okay.
I'm trying really hard to understand this new concept. Okay, you ready? I think your builder's probably going to have to answer some of this too.
I'm sure he is.
Okay. This is a franchise, correct?
Yes, it is.
So do you work with Meijer? Is that who you got?
So I guess I should touch a little bit more on that. So yes, Big B Coffee is a franchise. They have approximately 250 stores, primarily in Michigan, but they've now touched several other states, probably down in Florida, Texas, outside of this. What they opened up recently was like a Big B Shark Tank, where they allow for people to bring different concepts in. And at that point, Jeff brought his concept in of the Big B Coffee BQ. What's so unique about this model of the Big B Coffee is that when you are stuck and you don't have lease space or something to use, or you just have a nice grass out lot, you can take this, place it there, make it look awesome, and open up a coffee shop. How it came about being in Swords Creek was Jeff also worked with Meijer, and they love the concept. And as you can imagine, Meijer does a lot of research on their store locations. So Meijer came back to Bigby Coffee and gave them 6 locations that they could try this model out. 3 of them being in Ohio, Bigby came back and said, let's do the 3 Michigan stores first. Number 2 on that list just so happened to be Swords Creek. So knowing that it was in our backyard and something we've always wanted to have in Swords Creek, they offered it to us first.
So it's like a beta site then, a try.
I think we're past the beta stage. Actually.
Yeah.
Okay.
So the beta site is in the parking lot at Meijer in Alpena, Michigan. It's my own store.
All right. I'm going to, just so everybody out here knows the verbiage or the stuff that I'm going to be using. NFPA stands for the National Fire Protection Agency. ASTM is, that's the company that checks for fire ratings. And they do different kinds of tests. Type 5 construction, I looked what that was, and I'll go into that later. And this follows the International Building Codes, correct? IBC? Okay, that's, and SIP is a structural insulated panels, that's what it's made of, right?
Correct.
Okey-doke. So is this a type 5 construction?
It is.
Okay. All right. I did contact the NFPA. I'm a member of that, and they did give me a response and some material that I'm sure you probably looked at before. And I'm going to ask some questions about the health and safety of this building.
Sure.
Okay. I'm glad you're here. All right.
Me too.
So. Okay.
I'm right. Pretty mixed.
This has to do with just general.
Sure.
Questions here. Who is responsible for this site? It's not an official outlot. If you look at your plans, Meijer does not have it named as an outlot. So who is responsible for the site? Like snow and ice removal on the sidewalks, would that be Meijer or is that Big B?
Well,
it
would be Abbott.
Okay. If you go on your webpage, it says one of the pluses that they mentioned on the website webpage was that if it doesn't work out, you can just go in and lift up the whole thing and take it off.
Correct.
So everything that's left behind, if you decide you're going to move this whole thing out, who's responsible for cleaning up what's left on the site?
Yeah, there's actually part of my release requires within 30 days that all evidence of the building being there is removed and restored to, in this case, it would be grass. So all the foundations are pulled out and everything is removed and it turns back into grass.
Okay.
Within 30 days.
Good. What's the lifespan of the materials that you're using in this? That I could not find.
Yeah, I think, the way that I designed the building, the way I built it and build them essentially is we try to use products that, keep in mind, the first one is my own. And so I developed VA clinics, one of the largest VA clinic operators in the country. And because those are full service leases, we're required to handle everything on maintenance. And so I employed a lot of that technology into this building on purpose. So the roof, as an example, is Duralast. I personally have a 50-year-old Duralast roof that's made in Saginaw. And that's what we use in these cubes. The exterior skin is concrete-based. The lifespan is well beyond 50 years.
You still use Endurawall?
I do. Endurawall is a fantastic product.
Okay. So you don't know how long it's going to last. They haven't been up long enough. Yes?
Well, that's true. That's true, but it's a cementitious product.
Okay.
So it's going to be there quite a long time.
So if there is an accident, this is just me, or damages, or a fire, or somebody gets hurt, who's ultimately responsible? The owner?
Yes.
So he's required to meet all the standards that health department, fire,
yes.
All that?
Yes.
Okay. Generally, they have to put a new sanitary sewer line across and a new water line. Who pays for that?
I do.
All right, and again, it's not an outlot originally, but Meijer leased it as what it is. Okay, there's that page. Okay, so I looked up all the different parts.
parts of this building, and insole span, is that what you're still using for the panels?
Yes.
Right? Okay, that was in there, so that
was
good.
There was machine.
All right, and DuraWall is the out you're going to use on the exterior walls.
That's correct.
And sit panels throughout the whole thing.
That's the structure.
Aluminum, aluminum windows.
Yes, ready access.
All right.
Do you have any questions on any of those things specifically, or just...
Okay, yes, it's in here. Okay, like I said, I contacted, his name is Milton Werner, he's a building and safety person through NFPA. And light commercial or multi-use buildings of type 5 fire-rated construction often require a one-hour fire rating and or sprinkler systems. Many SIP manufacturers can provide tested assemblies for both walls and roofs that meet the one-hour fire resistance test outlined in ASTM E119. Okay. One of the things I couldn't figure out whether this had, and I'll read some stuff out of the actual report of your that they required that you have met. Wind. It look, you know, it looks like, you know, it's hooked on four spaces, and they mentioned shear walls.
Actually, it's hooked on 11.
Good. So, do they have shear walls in this at all?
The structure currently meets 115 miles an hour sustained wind.
Okay. All right. Okay, here's the thing I got when I looked up Type 5 construction. And it says, any structure requiring a permit to build, alter, or remodel must be classified by type of construction and occupancy. The International Building Code is the foundation of the codes adopted by most municipalities, and Adamson, that's what we use.
That's correct.
The IBC specifies five types of construction. Each is defined by materials used to build it. Material requirements range from being totally non-combustible to being constructed with any material allowed by the code, which is what you say is type 5.
Mm-hmm.
And type 1 is the best. Type 5 is, they use the story of the three little pigs, and they said type 5 is like when it's the straw house. So that didn't impress me very much. And there's also, types are further classified as A or B. A is rated as fire resistant, B is not. Fire resistance is measured in the hours it takes for fire to burn through the material. Type VA construction classification would require structural framing and bearing walls to have a one-hour fire resistance rating, meaning a fire would take an hour to burn through the wall. And type VB, 5B would have no fire resistance rating necessary, making it the most combustible and susceptible to fire. Do you know what your fire rating is for this building?
We meet the requirements, all requirements related to fire.
Of type 5 A or B?
B.
Oh. So it's the lowest... Fire.
Keep in mind, SIP panels are used to build hotels.
That's
and
fine.
Dwellings.
Okay. So this is the report that when it was insole, whatever, insole, something or other. And this is the report that he returned to me, the evaluation. And it has all the tests that are that were done and on these panels. And it's by the, it's an ICCES report. Okay, and it's for them, and what some of the, I just will highlight some of the stuff in here. It says, the panels are alternatives to walls, floors, and roofs designed in accordance with the IBC section 2306. Panels used in one-hour fire resistance rated assemblies must be installed in accordance with section 424, and there's a lot of stuff here. But do you know what inspections are required as they're putting this on the site?
Actually, this building is pre-wired, pre-plumbed, and fully inspected by both State of Michigan Mechanical, State of Michigan Electrical, and the local building official according to International Building Code and the current Michigan Building Code in Alpena, Michigan. So it's actually a moved structure.
What structure?
A moved structure under
right.
the International Building Code. So this building, when it arrives in Swartz Creek, has already been fully inspected and approved by both the State of Michigan and the Michigan Building Code and International Building Code, which is essentially synonymous. So the only real inspections that are done in Swartz Creek are the utility connections on the outside. And of course the health department approvals, but that's a walkthrough that
to this document, it says the panels must be installed in accordance with the manufacturer's published installation instruction in this report.
They are.
A copy of the installation instructions must be available at all times on the job site during installation, and panel locations must comply with the report and the plans and specifications approved by the code official.
They are.
The next thing says, wall openings must be framed with conventional materials designed to the satisfaction of the code official.
They are.
Okay. The wall panels used as bearing walls must be installed in the manner described in the footnotes in tables 6 through 8 when used as shear walls. Are they shear walls?
They are.
Okay. The wall panels, the thermal barrier, do you have thermal barriers?
We do.
It says wall, roof, and floor.
We do.
1/2 inch thick regular gypsum wall board?
We are 5/8, which is 1 hour rate.
Complying with da-da-da-da-da. All right. It says how it's supposed to be. It says an approved thermal barrier must be installed over the top surface of the floor panels.
Correct.
All right. I'm impressed. Good thing you're here. All right. Underlayment and flashing must be installed in accordance with applicable code. That's a roof covering.
Yeah, there is no underlayment required. It's direct placed.
All right. Fire-resistant, limited load-bearing wall with a 6.5 inch thick dimensional lumber spline panels. I have no idea what that means.
Those are the splines that connect the panels together.
That's wood, right?
Correct.
It says we're supposed to be using spruce, pine, or fir.
Pine.
All right.
You can't buy the others very easily in the United States.
All right.
Pine is what we're using.
Okay. The panels must be fabricated, identified, and installed in accordance with this report, and whatever is the most restrictive will apply.
Correct.
Okay. Design loads to be resisted by the panels must be determined in accordance with the applicable code, must be equal to or less than the values given in all these tables. Gotcha. Design calculations and details for specific applications must be furnished to the code official verifying compliance with this report and applicable.
Yes, we have to do that.
Showing the load path for the transfer of lateral, foam plastic insulation must be separated from the interior of the building with a thermal barrier.
It is.
Good. The panels must be installed such that the panel facings are protected against decay and termites. I have a question. It's up in the air. How do you keep critters out? And if I'm assuming the water and the electrical comes from below, if something goes wrong, is there enough room to repair?
So we don't actually, the only penetrations in the building are actually inside. All the utility connections actually connect to the outside. So we don't come into the floor, we come into the wall, essentially. So electric panels, internet connection, water connection, sewer connection, all of that is done on the outside.
So how do you keep critters out from below?
Well, there's a steel frame. It's 10 inch tall by 6 inches wide. And then we curve it. And then we create weeps in the curve to let water through. But it looks like a curve.
We also plan on doing cement below it. So.
That's required, I think, because you've got to have something to hook it on. Okay, the panels and their attachments must be subject to inspection by the code official prior to covering an approved water resistant barrier or roof covering. So that's one of the things that our person has to approve before they put anything on.
Well, the building is complete when it leaves OB. So the only real inspection involvement is the utility connections to the boxes. Nothing else really changes. The building's complete. There's no on-site construction. This building will show up, if approved, to Swartz Creek Raft. The crane will arrive, and in under 3 hours it will be built.
Nobody gets to look at it in case something's been damaged and anything.
I'm at every single installation.
Good. Okay. What kind of roof is it? Class A, B, or C?
I'm not sure. I don't have the answer there.
Okay. It says for installations of the roof panels.
Oh, the I don't know. We actually meet the energy code, ICC energy code. We are 19% better than the current requirement, and our electronics and lighting are 76% better, according to the ICC ComCheck reports.
Okay, the panels must have a label containing the name and address of the sandwich panel manufacturer. You're going to have all that put
yep.
on this.
Yep.
All right, here's all this. Then they talk about the weight. This is an interesting question here. We have a second level on this plan.
We do.
How do you get into it?
There is an access hatch in the bathroom. It is only, the only reason to get up there is to change the reverse osmosis filters in the water filtration system, or to service the RPZ check valve, essentially, to the water system.
What kind of furnace is up there?
There is none.
How do you heat it?
We heat and cool it with a mini split system, which is no ducts at all. And it's, keep in mind, the entire space is 349 square feet, so it's very small. The system is extremely efficient.
So where is that located?
It's actually, it's hanging on the wall. You've probably seen it in hospitals, mechanical rooms, etc. It's a white, basically called a head, but it basically is a fan coil. And the compressor, like you would have in an air conditioner, is actually on the outside of the building, down low, that gets screened.
Okay. Do you have one in the bathroom area, or just one in the main area?
It's actually, there's one compressor and two heads. So there's a 2.5 ton, which is far more than is needed. A 2.5 ton compressor and 2 1.5 ton heads in two different locations inside. We do not have heat in the bathroom. That sounds odd, but there's a reason for it. One, the bathroom typically the bathroom door is typically closed, and so we actually draw hot and cold air into that through a rheostat system on a fan, essentially. So it gets to a certain temperature and it turns it on to bring air in.
Okay. Now these are my safety type questions, I guess, here. I mean, it's a small space.
It is.
You only got one entry?
Yes, but both windows are accessible when they're open, large enough.
They're large enough that if somebody had to get out.
We absolutely need code. Absolutely need code.
Now, storage.
Yes.
I know you have to have cleaning chemicals and stuff separate from your other stuff. I didn't see any amount of storage indicated anywhere on the
plan. Right. So, the cube, the whole idea behind the cube is it's much smaller space with all the same amenities. So the equipment in the building is exactly the same as, what size is your Burton Solar Cloud Store?
1300.
So 1300 to 1700 square feet. We have exactly the same equipment, exactly the same square footage of storage for cups and boxes and all of that in the cube. It's efficient shelving, so it's actually above the workspaces. There's storage in the bathroom. All the cleaning chemicals that could be used are from Ecolab, and those distribution points are at all of the sinks.
So they're like on the wall?
Yes, but they're automatically metered.
Right.
So.
Okay, so two spaces don't mix as far as that storage, okay. What about employees, again, the safety of your employees? You got a 3-foot wide aisle for them to move back and forth.
Yes.
Are there chairs at all that go in there?
There are none.
How long are their shifts?
Right.
Anywhere from 4 to 8 hours.
So 8 hours they have to stand.
Sure. It's pretty normal.
No breaks. There's no break space. Where do they put the personal items to, this is just me.
It's going to be strange, but believe it or not, there's coat hooks.
Where?
Behind the door in the bathroom. So it's a right-hand swing door.
Is it a self-closing door?
No.
Okay. extinguishers?
Yes.
Smoke alarms?
No.
Why not?
Not necessary, not required.
Why?
Because it's not necessary in the code.
But you wouldn't want to put one in there?
Well, you can see every corner of the building.
Not upstairs, where the...
Where the tower is, upstairs.
The top of the tower.
I suppose, but it's not really required, so...
Here's another weird thing. Why is the breaker box on the outside?
Well, good reason, actually. So all the plugs are GFCI. So when you're operating a store and you have all of your electrical connections, your plugs, et cetera, below on top of the tables, the stainless tables, if you pop a breaker, as an example, in the espresso machine or a grinder for whatever reason, to dig under the tables and move tables to try to find the GFCI button to push in, the actual panel itself is a GFCI, so you literally can see much better, much safer, walk outside and see the breaker that is blown, rather than digging underneath the tables trying to find the connection.
I just have never heard of, in any commercial building, having a breaker box on outside.
There's a reason for it. Well, we specifically did it that way on purpose.
So does that meet code?
Yes. Listen, we would not be able to send it to you if it wasn't meeting code. Yeah, I mean, state of Michigan inspectors for plumbing, mechanical, electrical are all done.
Okay, weight load for the upper, that means the walls are fine?
Absolutely.
Okay. How about ADA requirements?
Not required.
So you can't hire anybody that has any disability?
It's, you're talking about two employees, it's not required.
So what is the size of the mop sink? It kept varying from picture to picture. Does it take up a whole corner that's never anywhere in your plan?
No, I think it's in the plan.
Nah, I didn't find it anywhere.
It's actually a laundry tub is the mop sink. Typically, in a big store, you have a floor-mounted mop sink. In our brick-and-mortar store, my brick-and-mortar store, we have a floor-mounted mop sink. And the idea is you have a very large full pail of cleaning water that you mop the floor with, and someone has to lift it up.
Heavy, I know what they are.
Right? So, in a 349 square foot building, you only have this much water in the mop bucket. It's not required to have a floor mounted sink, so it's much more efficient than a laundry tub size.
In the bathroom.
In the bathroom, correct.
Okay.
Thank you.
Let's see. Some of the stuff on your actual plans, I didn't get a good first impression that the first page says extensive site work, not typical, photos taken before site work completed. It's like, okay, that's not good. There's a lot of typical words throughout your plans, on the floor plans, typical, typical, and it says drawing, diagrammatical in nature, so it's not
right.
Scale.
No, it's the scale. The issue is...
And it also says scale varies on the foundation and concrete, and also it wasn't good when I looked at the sinks and it says Wayne County, not Genesee County, for the health department on the sinks.
Actually, the plan you're referring to, in Wayne County, they require an ice bay in the table itself, even though it's right next to the ice machine, which doesn't make a lot of sense to a lot of people. That's something they require. So we try to have the structural plans consistent throughout, no matter what community we're going to in Michigan. But we put that in parentheses. That's not the case here.
Okay. So what's Genesee County say you have
to have? Exactly what we have minus the ice bin. Okay. So there's a hand sink, there's a triple compartment sink like any other restaurant. There's a bathroom sink, there's a laundry sink.
So I went and stood where you're going to have this supposed built, and the low point is two catch basins and all that. It is right in the middle of your concrete driveway. So that's where the low point is between the two sanitary, not sanitary, but storm sewers. So you run with that water settling right there.
Don't get me wrong, but actually, the drive goes right between
right.
the storm, and we actually are tipping into the storm, so it's going to be crowned. So there won't be a low point there. It'll actually be the high point when it's natural.
Okay, so the normal drainage then will be changed for that area?
Not a bit. Because it's all flowing to that large storm.
There's two,
that's correct.
Right, and I also noticed, and this is just a question because it wasn't on the plan either, there's a fire hydrant. Which side of the fire hydrant will your driveway be on? Or do they have to move it?
North. Is the bank of the north?
Yes.
Yeah, so the north.
So it'll be right next to your drive, right?
The fire hydrant, that's, I don't know how many feet away, but it's certainly have to be moving the fire hydrant.
My final thought, so to speak, is that the bank that they built on their outlot was required to meet code and building standards that are pretty high, and they did it. They put curbs, they got nice, the site looks nice. We just went through a couple weeks ago for the new townhomes, and the city of Swartz Creek wanted it to really look like, I mean, we made them, you know, porches, everything to a really high standard. We got a new downtown streetscape, and this business is, like I said, when I went on the site and they said, yep, if it doesn't work out, we'll just rip it out, take it out. It doesn't give me a sense of permanency. It would be nice. I absolutely think curbs and that sort of stuff are needed. Because another thing, people will just not stay where they're supposed to stay. I have the path behind my house, and where they don't have curbs, they just like run right over the mud, no matter what. So that definitely needs to be done. And for type 5 building, again, I appreciate you really have worked hard to make this fire safe. It's just so small. And one door, and are these windows, I know they said they're glazed, so that means they're tempered. And
yes.
Do you have a fire door that's rated a 1-hour fire door?
And the external one is a steel insulated fire door, yes.
Okay, it's not mentioned. It doesn't say it's a fire door in your plan. It just says it's painted. It has to be painted.
Yes.
And a lot of it is dependent upon, you have to make sure the person who is your construction person there, you said you're going to be there, has to make sure that all this stuff is met. And I sure hope so. It still seems... And it's not ADA. It's not required to be ADA. But they do say barrier-free, that the doorknobs and that have to be barrier-free.
They are. It's just not, ADA is not required in this building. But the lane between the tables and the equipment is certainly wide enough for ADA. All the interior doors are ADA.
3 feet, that's the
right
width?
Yep, 36, right. Yep.
Okay.
It's just not...
3 feet. Right.
36 is what we have in the building, both the exterior door and the interior
okay.
bathroom door.
I can't think of anything else. Next.
Yes, I have just a brief comment. I'd like to acknowledge that due to the type of building it is, that would necessitate material, color, and roof provisions to be waived. That was a concern of mine when I read the information in the city council packet, but now I understand. My questions have been answered during the in-depth conversation you've had.
Sorry.
Mr. Gilbert.
Yes. The water and sewer come in through the wall.
They do.
How do you insulate them? I mean,
right. So, what we employ in a VQ is what's called a forced main system. It actually pressurizes and ejects the product out, and so we still go down below frost. But the insulation that we put around the pipe, our sewer discharge is 2 inches, and we can pump up to 1,000 feet in any direction. It doesn't require us to have any specific slope. Reduces the amount of excavation that has to take place for the directional board. It does not have to be on a given slope. So it's very adaptive to the situation. You don't have giant excavations and worry about your slope and connections. So we really could connect uphill. We don't. We try not to, but we could. insulate that is we, the 2-inch discharge on the sewer is right next to a 2-inch sleeve before the water. And so below frost, the connections are made, valves are connected. And then we come up through a 10-inch insulated pipe.
Okay.
So it's 10 inches in diameter, and it's actually employed in pig farms in the winter so that they can run 40 below and still not have issues with freezing. Now, last winter, we ran Alpena, and we had a week of minus 45, and you wouldn't even know it.
Okay. Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Other questions?
Do you want to see this just for fun?
I probably have them in my files.
Mrs. Rude.
In the city manager's report, it says that the planning consultant feels that this is an essential requirement and should not be waived in regards to the curb. So could we just talk a little bit about what that controversy was or why we might want to waive the curb or not waive the curb? I don't know.
It's a requirement in our code. In special land use, you can waive certain requirements. Again, one I stand by is the need for a traffic study. There was a big traffic study done when Tetra Tech was reviewing the Myers site. There was a lot of capacity at this point in time for the public streets and the drives. And so with those findings, it was indicated they could waive that requirement. So curbing can be waived. The planning consultant, and again, she's available, believes we should not deviate from our standard and that it has a functional purpose. And that was the conversation Planning Commission had. I believe, I can't speak for all the members, that was probably why the vote was 5-4 instead of something more affirmative. And so staff stands behind that recommendation from the planner and should be something we consider here this evening. But I can't speak for individual members of Planning Commission, but it was certainly discussed at length. There was no action taken to require curb at their meeting. They ultimately recommended approval without it. Does that help?
Yes. And what is the reason for not doing the curb? Like, why?
I can't answer that.
I think our position is it's not really necessary in that particular use. The curb around the building is something that is being utilized to guide. It's on the drive-through side. However, the drive-in, the entire Meyer site is Class C curb. So I think you can go to just about even the bank, you can find tracks through the grass. So I think it's really not a deterrent for vehicles, regardless of the weather. The lane is 12 feet wide, which is pretty wide in overall. So, we feel like curbing holds water and how it gets directed to the catch basins. Our goal is to have the high side push it to the catch basins as quickly as possible. So that's, a developer's preference is always to not have curb, particularly when we don't believe that really does much in this situation. There's lots of reasons.
Can we hear from the consultant as to why a curb would be needed?
Kelly McIntyre, CMN. There are numerous reasons why communities require curb gutter. The first is obviously so that we can collect and direct the stormwater. Another is that curb gutter prevents the soil erosion. If you have your asphalt coming to the edge, basically it comes to the edge and then there's grass, what happens is that can over time break up and then you're going to start losing your asphalt. The way that you construct concrete curb and gutter is actually there's an additional thickness and strength when they do that on the curbing area, so it extends the life of the asphalt. Let's see, what else? It protects the shoulders, it controls traffic. One of the advantages of concrete being light colored and asphalt is dark is that actually you can see there's a little bit of a difference. You can see the color that can help during in the evening. Also in poor weather, it's a lot easier to maintain to take snow plows through because of the edging. You're not scraping up potentially the landscape in that area. Those are just a few of the reasons why I would say almost every community I work in. It is required, it's part of their ordinance. I have not been accustomed to anyone waiving that standard on any current or new developments that we've worked with. Thank you, Dr. Moore.
Yeah. One more question. They waived the traffic study and they claimed the answer. They said there's not going to be any increase in traffic.
As far as the traffic, that I don't know. Traffic studies, there's a margin. Basically, if you generate more than a certain number of trips in a certain amount of time, a traffic study is required. I am not a traffic consultant. I just do zoning and planning, so that actually would go to a traffic engineer. If that's something that the city felt was necessary, looking at it, and the actual size, the number of stacking lanes, which I believe is not definitive, but I believe that there are enough number of stacking spaces that you aren't going to have any
blocking of any of
blocking. No, it is a pretty deep stacking lane. I don't believe there's going to be any.
And the exit drive is not too close to where they turn in. Oh, that's what I was going to ask. Are you going to have signs that say this is the entrance and this is the exit? So
yes.
People know?
Yes.
Because that was
and the pavement will be marked.
Because I didn't see any mention of that. So you're going to have entrance and exit signs, okay.
Is that it?
Right now.
All right. Anyone else? Any comments, questions?
The requirement for the three drive-through delivery spaces, what would be the reason for not needing that as well?
I can probably address that. I think mainly because Bigby's business is not allowed that. So they don't, unlike McDonald's, where if your food is not ready, they can pull you to number one to move you through. You're served at the window and you leave. There is no, can you please pull up? So these guys, their job is to make sure the customers are taken care of at the window and not stage it like that. It just isn't part of the
problem. Are there at like the normal brick and mortar Bigby's that are not BQ'd? Do they have?
No, I don't think so. That's not, it's not part of the business model. They want to take care of the customers right at the window.
Anyone else?
Yes, sir.
After the planning commission meeting, I did go and drive through the parking lot. And it is a Class C barrier curving throughout the parking lot into the minor. And they were driven over and severely uprooted. And it was pointed out, a gentleman has photos here today of the bank's curving, and it seems to be a full barrier curving. And I do think that that would be something crucial. And I would like to make a motion that we modify the resolution to require a curving.
That would be dropping exception number five.
I think that this has fantastic potential for the area, for the property around there. But to help that potential, it needs to maintain looking good. And I'd really like to see it built and built with a curving.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to drop number five in the results, which is stating that the requirement for curbing be waived, so we're going to drop the waiver of that according to the motion that's on the floor. Anyone wish to speak to that? If it passes, then they will have to. All right, Madam Clerk, we have a motion on the floor. We can call a roll on that.
Krieger?
Yes.
Pinkston?
Yes.
Root?
Yes.
Kramer?
Yes.
Farmer?
Yes.
Gilbert?
Yes.
Hicks?
Yes.
Looks like we're dropping waiver of the curbing, everything else at this point stays the same, and that resolution to accept. Anyone else? Anything else? Madam Clerk, would you call the roll?
Pinkston?
Yes.
Root?
Yes.
Kramer?
Yes.
Barmer?
Yes.
Gilbert?
Yes.
Hicks?
No.
Krieger?
Yes. Motion passed.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And moving right along to the meeting.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
Before we get to the meeting, we need to take a break.
It's a coffee. We need a coffee break.
We wouldn't have if Ray Linton wouldn't take 45 minutes to us.
I appreciate it.
No.
She looked like she'd been drinking though.
Moving on, we have 8B, the Owensburg Community Agreement for the Swartz Creek Youth Football. Deborah, would you read the motion, please?
Whereas the city owns certain land, the property, in the city of Swartz Creek, city, which is used for public purposes, and whereas the Swartz Creek Youth Football is a charitable organization recognized as such, pursuant to Section 501(c)(3) of the Internal Revenue Code, is engaged in the promotion of youth activity, athletics in the city, and whereas the user has constructed at its own expense, and with the city's permission, certain improvements on the property, which improvements are used for storage and related activities by the user and or by the other public, educational and athletic organizations with the permission of the user. And whereas the city finds the use of the property by the user and the construction by the user at its own expense of the improvements therein that should be insured.
Inures.
Huh?
Inures. It's language that was in the agreements that the attorney crafted.
Okay.
To inure a benefit is to give a benefit.
Okay.
I've looked it up too.
Yeah.
It's a legal term.
To the benefit of the city and its citizens and helps reduce the burden of government. And now therefore the city council hereby approves the park use agreement between the city of Swartz Creek and the city youth football as included in the August 12, 2019 City Council packet, and further directs the mayor and clerk to execute the agreements on behalf of the city.
Second.
Motion is made and seconded. Any speaking to the motion?
Bruce?
Just a minute. I have something. Not on the motion itself, but rather on the agreement. And that would be on page 78. Let me find the place here. Okay, in first and second lines of page 78, user without affecting the city's rights as contained in this agreement, but no receiver, trustee, or other judicial officer shall never have any right, title, or interest in or in the property by virtue of this agreement. By saying no receiver and shall never, you have a double negative, which means that they do have an interest in it. So I would suggest that we drop the end on never to ever. If you read it through and think about it.
Makes sense.
Otherwise we're saying exactly the opposite of what we want to say.
Agreed.
And that will come up on page 85 in the agreement for the next group. The same language, same problem. So
yeah.
I have to get in there also.
We have it.
Got it. Thank you. Anyone else?
So it changed never to ever?
Correct. So it's saying no one shall ever have instead of no one shall never have because.
Right.
All right, I believe we're ready to vote. Anyone else asking for the floor? Go ahead and call the roll, ma'am.
Ruth?
Yes.
Kramer?
Yes.
Farmer?
Yes.
Gilbert?
Yes.
Hicks?
Yes.
Krieger?
Yes.
Hingston?
Yes.
Motion passes. Thank you. Next item is 8C.
Whereas the city owns certain land, the property in the city of Swartz Creek City, which is used for public purposes, and whereas the Dragon Lax is a charitable organization recognized as such pursuant to section 501c3 of the Internal Revenue Code and is engaged in the promotion of youth athletics in the city, and whereas the city finds that the use of the property by user and the construction by the user at its own expense of the improvements therein inures to the benefit of the city and its citizens and helps reduce the burden of government. And now, therefore, the City Council hereby approves the park use agreement between the City of Swartz Creek and the Dragon Lax as included in the August 12, 2019 City Council packet and further directs the mayor and clerk to execute the agreements on behalf of the city.
Second.
Motion made and seconded. Mr. Zettel.
Aaron, motion adjusted.
Obviously, we know what youth football is. What is Dragon's Lax?
It's, think of it as lacrosse.
Oh.
But their incorporated name is LAX, but it is Swartz Creek Lacrosse.
Lacrosse. Thank you. Yes, sir, Mr. Gilbert.
How long does the youth football in this soccer, or not soccer, lacrosse, how often do they use the park?
Oh my gosh, since I'm coaching youth football now, I'll tell you, and I just came from there, they never leave. They're there a lot. Youth football is there, actually probably just the month of August through October, and I don't know what the club lacrosse schedule is, but when they use it, it's pretty intensive in the weekday evenings, 5 days a week.
Well,
and then they do have their summer camps, and I'm not sure if there's other groups throughout the year that exercise rights over the storage or not with under their umbrella. So they're most active, of course, a little bit in July and then August through, say, September, October.
Yeah, what about baseball?
Baseball stores all of their equipment on the fields they use at the elementary schools.
Okay.
They have sheds at those locations. That was a big discussion Park Board had, and Dave Krieger was instrumental in ensuring we wouldn't have issues down the road, that we didn't want to just keep adding sheds to the park.
Right.
We wanted to see what the total demand was going to be, and so they vetted the youth athletics groups generally. And baseball, of course, is the other big user. Since they're accommodated elsewhere, there didn't appear to be any apparent need to have to store equipment beyond these two groups. Soccer just doesn't have the equipment and doesn't spend much time in those fields. Of course, football has the most equipment based on what they do.
Okay. Anyone else? All right.
Kramer?
Yes.
Farmer?
Yes.
Gilbert?
Yes.
Hicks?
Yes.
Krieger?
Yes.
Hingston?
Yes.
Ruth?
Yes.
That passes. Next one is the park waiver request, resolution 8D. And we're back to Mrs. Ruth.
Whereas the City of Swartz Creek requires park usage reservations and fees in accordance with adopted rules and regulations, And whereas the General Federation of Women's Clubs, Swartz Creek Women's Club reserved Pavilion Number 2 in Abrams Park for Sunday, August 18, 2019, for the purpose of holding an annual meeting. And whereas the City Park Rules and Regulations states that fees may be waived in full if reservations by a nonprofit are found to result in a public benefit directly, or if proceeds from the reserved event are found to be a benefit to the city. And whereas the City Council finds the petitioning group to be a qualifying group with a qualifying activity, now therefore be it resolved, the Swartz Creek City Council hereby waives all fees for the August 18, 2019 reservation in Abrams Park.
Second.
Thank you. Would anyone like to speak to the motion? They always get the fee waived every year, and they do so much for our city. Madam Clerk, would you call the roll?
Farmer?
Yes.
Gilbert?
Yes.
Hicks?
Yes.
Krieger?
Yes.
Haston?
Yes.
Ruth?
Yes.
Kramer?
Yes.
Dr. Haston, you don't want to play like you got to think of all
that. Really?
It passes. Next is 8E, the budget adjustments. And Kramer, would you read that, please?
Absolutely. Whereas Act 621 of Public Act 1978 provides for a uniform budgeting system for local units of government, and whereas Act 275 of PA of 1980 further prohibits deficit spending by local units of government, and whereas the City Council has reviewed the city's 2018 to 2019 fiscal year budget and comparative year-to-date balance sheet of expenses and revenues, it finds that it is not in deficit. However, certain department activity line items may be in deficit. Whereas the City Council has received a budget amendment summary, and whereas new budget amounts necessitate adjustments to the original adopted budget. And whereas said supplemental documentation shows that the new proposed revenues and expenditures changes by account. Therefore, be it resolved, the Swartz Creek City Council hereby authorizes and directs the city manager or his designee to make all necessary year-end budget adjustments and amendments to all city funds in accordance with the supplemental documentation.
Pages 110 to 119.
Pages 110 to 119, thank you. Attached. Be it further resolved, the Swartz Creek City Council hereby authorizes and directs the city manager or his designee to make all necessary year-end budget adjustment amendments.
Second.
Mrs. Court is here if there's questions, and make no mistake, she's the one that put in all the hard work and has all the knowledge that makes these financial housekeeping necessities possible. So it's a lot of hard work, it's a grind. And so even though the resolution template language to city managers, definitely Deanna and all the hard work she does.
He's asking us to ask her questions so she doesn't get to
wait. She waited all this time.
Yes.
She waited. Okay, so if we adopt this, where does the money come from that we're changing the budget to?
Okay. Well, these are the adjustments that we cannot make just internally between departments, so that's why we have to come back to you for the adjustments. When you approve the budget, you approve it in groups of departments. So when I bring these, it's because within that group, in that department, I can't zero out the changes. This one's higher, this one's lower. If you look at this, you're increasing your revenue and it decreases expenses in 101, just as an example on the first one. So that means that you're using additional fund balance if you have higher expenses than you do revenues. But it does not create the deficit situation. It's just changing, you're adding, in this case for general fund, $57,000 in revenue, and you have increases in expenses. So you would be increasing expenses, or in this case, you would be decreasing expenses by $217,000. So the biggest one, of course, on that was your construction on Holland Square that we have an estimate for. That one is the $228,000. When the engineers give us their project costs and you guys approve them, that's for the cost of the entire project. Then they will talk to me afterward and say, we think we're going to have 40% or 50% of that completed by your June 30th date. So that's what I budget for the 1 year and the balance for the next year. When we get to that point and they haven't spent all that money yet in by June, then we adjust it off of June, we increase that money for the next year's budget. So a lot of times, especially with projects, you'll see that throughout this document, because those are our best guesses of when those expenses are going to fall or when those revenues are going to come in.
Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome.
That's a question.
Yes, sir, Mr. Kramer.
Yes. Several questions. One reference to Act 51, another question about Fund 202, and another question about Fund 590. First of all, can you please explain to me what an MTT settlement, the acronym, what's MTT?
Michigan Tax Tribunal.
Oh, okay.
That's thank when you. They take, when we've done the assessment role and Heather produces that, then if someone does not agree with their assessment, if they don't get satisfaction at board review or don't go to board review, they can go directly to the Michigan Tax Tribunal and file.
Okay, thank you. Act 51 revenues for maintenance from the state increased. Caught me by surprise.
Yes, I'm
normally, when I read that, bear in mind this is, you know, not exactly novel material that I'm reading. But it caught me by surprise, and I was going, you get an increase? What's going on?
They had newer software that they used to make their estimated projections last year, and they issued a document on that midway through this year that when they had that software being installed, they made estimates themselves for what they thought was going to be the end result. And after the software was installed, they found that they had left out or miscalculated something, and it changed a lot of their numbers for this year. In some cases, there were decreases to some areas, and they withheld funds from their last payments. In our instance, we received more. So we were on the good end of whatever their estimate was.
Wow.
But they project in the future up to a year and a half out before we get them. So they're making estimates on data that, you know, a lot could change on anyway. So for the first time in quite a while,
yeah,
we always budget just a little lower anyway because they generally reduce it. So this was a shock to surprise when the last payment was coming in and we were in pretty good shape at that point.
Caught me by surprise. Caught me by surprise.
Me too, they don't tell you these things are
going to happen. Yeah, right here. The next question is on Fairchild TIF project, Fund 202, construction, engineering expenditures decreased.
That is the expenses. So for the year we're budgeted at $78,000 because that's what the estimate was that they were going to actually spend by the time our June 30th got here. It's that fiscal year issue that Adam has talked about before too. We have a cutoff right in the middle of the construction season. So they have to guess where we're going to be at. So I always refer to the engineers and ask them, where do you think these projects are going to be at? So when you see that this is a decrease here, you're going to see that money budgeted now as an adjustment to 20 with the project, I move that over. So that's going to get moved on anything that's a project.
Yeah.
If there's a, if it was less, we would move it in the other direction. So the whole project itself in total comes out, with, but it crosses the fiscal years, sometimes two, sometimes three, depending on the length of the project.
Okay. And my final question on the subject matter is Fund 590, the water fund. Water fees were lower than estimated. Material services, metered services, excuse me, meter services increased. Is there this direct correlation with the KWA fees?
That's what I'm going to be looking more into, because we really were just getting data in this last year to be forecasted as to where that stood. So that was something I'm looking at. It was, there was kind of a flip-flop of sorts between those.
Okay.
So in my narrative, I mentioned that that's something that I want to explore, and since we're already into this new budget year, I can't say where we're going to end up for this one, but it's something to think about when I'm preparing the next one and look at where we are at in this one.
Okay. Well, thank you.
You're welcome.
Appreciate it.
So water fees are the readiness to serve charge, and the meter fees are the actual consumption commodity. So that's the distinction in those two revenues.
Thank you.
Other questions from anyone? No? All right, then, good. We're ready to vote on making those adjustments.
Gilbert?
Yes.
Hicks?
Yes.
Krieger?
Yes.
Pinkston?
Yes.
Ruth?
Yes.
Kramer?
Yes.
Farmer?
Yes.
Thank you. Motion passes. The next item is the outdoor ordinance. That'd be a good one for Mr. Kramer.
Thank you, Your Honor. Whereas the City of Swartz Creek maintains police power over various activities and performance standards related to maintaining the health, safety, and welfare of the public, and whereas the ability to define and regulate odors in the community has been noted as a deficiency in providing for health, safety, and welfare of the public. Now, therefore, I move the City of Swartz Creek ordains City of Swartz Creek Ordinance Number 442, an ordinance to amend Chapter 9 of the Code of Ordinances by adding thereto a new section entitled Odors.
That's all you got to do.
And the odors specifically, Article 8 is about marijuana establishments.
That's a Scribner's error carryover from the prior ordinance. It'll just be Section 9.5 odors, which is under nuisances. It certainly will apply to some of the complaints we've been having about marijuana growing operations, home grows, not anything commercial or industrial.
Right.
Since we don't allow that.
Questions, comments? Mr. Gilbert.
Yes. Okay. If we pass this.
Just a minute, Mr. Gilbert. We don't have a second yet.
Second.
All right, now.
Okay. Now, if we pass this, according to this, if a person has a fireplace, they can't have a fire because of the smoke. And another thing is, how do you regulate skunks? Because I'm telling you, there's a lot of them in it around. Can't shoot a gun in the city.
You can't regulate nature unless somebody was responsible for the skunk.
Okay, but my question is about a fireplace, or some people have a little, you can buy them in Myers or wherever.
Oh, yeah.
You can have a little
chimney
fire
or something like that. Yeah.
Yeah.
So we don't allow open burning or waste burning. So any burning that does occur should be in something like you described, and should be clean fuel.
But it says, property or
safety, and general welfare of the public that results from the emission of odor, chemicals, gas, smoke, fumes, or other materials or processes across any parcel or property line. That's in definition.
That's what we're talking about. Will Chief Bade address how that is enforced in his line of work?
I don't recall ever having a complaint of chimney smoke, wood smoke. If that was to come about, the variables that are enumerated under the prohibition section of this ordinance are very well defined for enforcement. One of those being intensity and character of the odor. When it's referring to a nuisance order, obviously at some point, if a group of neighbors insisted upon complaining about a neighbor who was burning wood in their fireplace, we would probably at some point have to take the complaint. That would be interpreted by a judge at some point, I would imagine. That's how, just as any ordinance is interpreted by the court. But typically, these odors that are being referenced are those that are of a nuisance type, the character of the odor that's being emitted.
This smoke, fumes, should not even be in there. If we pass this, that means...
It would depend on what you're burning.
No, but I mean, if you're burning wood, sometimes it smokes.
Right. That's not typically considered a nuisance.
I certainly think that's reflected in the intent. I remember one of the DPW employees indicating that someone they had lived next to used to burn hair, like they had a hair salon or something in their house, home occupation. Well, okay, that would be a nuisance. And I think a rational patrol officer would find it as such, and a judge would probably agree. I think in this community, if somebody were burning wood and there was a complaint, I suspect patrol officers would find it to be a reasonable smoke or fume. And that the character or odor of it was not a nuisance. If it somehow was, the issue was pressed and it got in front of Judge McCabe or whoever it is anymore, I suspect they'd have the same findings, but we don't know. The intent is certainly to go after things that are bothering most people. And that is difficult for patrol officers sometimes to interpret character and intensity of something like that. But they do a pretty good job of it. In practice, I don't think we've had any wood fire complaints in the city.
No,
period.
I didn't.
Yeah. Well, we do get a lot of other ones that do involve smoke or burning of some other waste that we do want to enforce. And so my point is I do think it's important to keep odor, fumes, smoke in the ordinance and then allow our officers the discretion to ascertain when it's a nuisance and when it isn't.
I believe, Mr. Gilbert, your concern is that some neighbor doesn't have a dispute with another neighbor and is going to complain about something that shouldn't be complained about. Just to give them a little trouble. It happens. It does happen. Mr. Kramer?
I believe it was a year and a half or 2 years ago, we had a group of residents from Condominium Association of Bristol Road.
Heritage,
yes. And complained about the odors that were emanating in that community, that area, from the manufacturing of marijuana.
Growing
marijuana. To the point where it was a concern on this council and in the community. And I think this new ordinance will help curtail that situation.
That's precisely what it's addressed to. Anyone else?
You might address that, but that's not what this says.
Say that specifically, but referencing the frequency of the occurrence of the odor, I don't think someone's going to have a campfire in the morning and in the night, but someone may go out on their porch in the morning and the night and burn other things. And the intensity and character of the odor, I think most people, I've not heard anybody comment negatively about the smell of a campfire. Anytime I smell that, I want to follow it and be there.
I do have neighbors who heat their homes with wood fires, and when the wind is coming from the right direction, I can smell it all day and all night long. But it doesn't bother me in the least. I know what's going on. It's not an objectionable thing. Other comments or discussion? I believe then we're ready to vote on the ordinance.
Hicks?
Yes.
Krieger?
Yes.
Pinkston?
Yes.
Ruth?
Yes.
Kramer?
Yes.
Farmer?
No.
Gilbert?
No.
Motion does pass. Moving on. On that resolution, I do have something needs to be changed in the typo. Let's see, page 26, where the resolution is, I believe. Line 2, under number 2.
Is this AG?
Yes. Where it says, annoyance or discomfort of that, I think you should say, or that, unreasonably interferes. Because of that does not make sense. See what I'm talking about?
No.
The annoyance or discomfort.
Line two, definition. The F should be an or, or an R, so it says or.
Oh, I see.
Is that correct, Mr. Zell? I believe also that it's a typo there?
It is typo, yeah.
Okay. We'll correct that in 4 minutes. Thank you. Moving on to 8G. 0175 from the stop sign at the lane.
Whereas the city owns and operates a system of major and local streets, including traffic control devices, and whereas Chapter 18, Article 2 of the Swartz Creek City Charter adopts the provisions of the Michigan Manual on Uniform Traffic Control Devices, 2009 edition, and whereas Section 1A.08 of the Michigan Manual on Uniform Traffic Control Devices, 2009 edition, grants local control of the regulation of traffic devices, and whereas Public Act 235 of 1969, MCL 257.942, enables municipal control over parking areas, parking access points, and related traffic control devices when requested by the owner or operator of such a site. And whereas the city conducted a traffic study that recommends removing the stop sign traffic control device from the south approach to the Cappy and Fairchild intersection, said approach being shared jurisdiction between the city and the parking lot access point for the Swartz Creek Middle School. And whereas the superintendent of the Swartz Creek Community Schools desires to follow the recommendation of the engineering report, and whereas the street administrator and staff from the Metro Police Authority of Genesee County recommend removing the stop sign. Now therefore be it resolved that the City of Swartz Creek approve traffic control ordinance number 175 as a permanent order and direct the staff to remove stop sign in accordance with the MTCD.
Are we a second for that?
Second.
Thank you. Any discussion?
Is the latest edition of that. There's nothing since then of the charter.
We could write as amended if there is a new version, but I don't know if there is a new Michigan Uniform Traffic Code, Annual Uniform Traffic Code devices.
don't think so. Okay. All right. So we're ultimately responsible for okaying taking down that stop sign?
Yes.
Not the school?
Correct.
And if something happens because we took the stop sign down?
Something probably will happen at some point, to be clear.
Okay.
Because it is an intersection. And that's
so
just
we have a
statistically list. What we can count on. It may be 100 years, it may never happen. I expect it would. Ultimately, OHM, fortunately for them, probably takes on a lot of liability for reducing the traffic engineering report.
Okay. And it's going to be marked that we took it down and yada yada for a while so that people realize.
Yeah, there's still a lot of work to be had.
We don't have any road rage because someone honks or whatever.
Right, and I hope it's something the school can communicate as they get into the new year. There's going to be a lot of change occurring there. The school is going to be reconfiguring their entire parking area to accommodate the contemporary need for student drop-off by parents and directing traffic based on, I believe they even had a concept where based upon the student's last name, they'd approach south side versus the north side to try to break up the traffic. And so they're going to be reconfiguring ingress, egress, how the parking lot works, how many spaces are there, and the pedestrian access accordingly is going to be all sent to the west, crossing the west side of the bridge. The intent is to keep all pedestrians off the east side of the bridge by physically creating a barrier. And so there shouldn't be any need for pedestrians to cross where we had the incident at Cappy Lane from east to west on Fairchild.
So will the stop sign come down first before all the
stop sign
changes?
Will come down first.
Okay.
We had not restriked the crosswalk at that location, and we'll see if we can move in working with Safe Routes to School and the school itself here to create that barrier so that we do not have any apparent need for students to be on the east side of that bridge.
Okay.
So there's, again, the Safe Routes to School is one initiative. The school bonding improvements resulting in parking lot pedestrian changes is another component of this. And then, of course, the study we did based on the current function of that intersection is the third one and the one we're basing our change on. So there'll be a lot of change and a lot of education that has to occur before the dust truly settles at this location.
So Safe Routes to School, how are the counties and schools starting very quickly?
Well, they're clearly won't be any changes this year. Their intent is to draft. They're going to be at our next meeting to present. They'll give a full presentation and timeline at that point. But their intent is going to be to try to write grants for implementation in 2020 or 2021. A lot of that could depend on the improvement so that it aligns with what the school is anticipating changing. Because they do anticipate doing a lot of work at the athletic facilities located at the high school, for example. And that might even change the grade of the hill, enabling a wider sidewalk on Fairchild, if you can envision that. So there's a lot of work that the school's doing that could tie into improvements that the Safe Routes to School group is going to be recommending.
Thank you. Other questions or comments?
Yes, sir. Please forgive my ignorance here. I struggled with the packet. I like the idea, but I'd just like to clarify, is the intent of removing that stop sign to discourage any idea that that is a crosswalk, and it just maintains north-southbound traffic consistently?
I mean, the basis for it is more predicated on the rationale that's outlined in the engineer's letter. Independent of that, we do want to eliminate crossings at that location.
Very good.
Other comments or questions? Madam Clerk, we're ready to go.
Krieger?
Yes.
Paxton?
Yes.
Ruth?
Yes.
Kramer?
Yes.
Farmer?
Yes.
Gilbert?
Yes.
Hicks?
Yes.
Motion passes. We have a request for another break, so we will take another 5 minutes. And moving on to resolution 8H, GIS mapping and a base proposal. And work at
Yes. Whereas the city owns, operates, and maintains a system of sewer collection lines, water distribution lines, storm sewer lines, and related valves, manholes, and other.
That would be an R, appurtenances?
Yep. Appurtenances, and whereas such infrastructure is largely underground, and the associated maps that convey location depth and related data are inaccurate, missing, or incomplete, and whereas the need for documentation and efficient maintenance, as well as holistic assessment management, make the ability to locate and track ongoing data for such infrastructure essential, and whereas technology exists to effectively locate and map such infrastructure using geographic information system maps and databases, and whereas the Genesee County Drain Commission Water and Waste Services Division is also engaging in GIS mapping services with the intention of reimbursing communities some of the costs associated with water and sewer line mapping services. Now therefore, be it resolved, the City of Schwartz Creek hereby approves the proposal from Rowe Professional Services Company dated July 30th, 2019, in the amount of $39,850 plus a 10% contingency. Funds to be appropriated to the Water 590, Sewer 591, and other applicable funds as determined by the City Treasurer.
Second.
Motion is made and seconded. Anyone wish to speak to the motion?
Yes.
With this implementation of that new technology, GIS mapping services, we're going to save time on the ground, work hours, right?
We should.
There'll be a lot of labor hours saved in updating records, searching for underground infrastructure, water turn on, turn off, valve boxes especially, and other water valves for system lines. That'll happen. I don't have a number of how many labor hours you're going to spend or what it might be reduced to. But it'll also help a lot with our ongoing maintenance efforts and just having a well-codified system, meaning as we exercise water valves routinely, we'll have a map that indicates which ones were done, say, in 2019 and 20, so we know which third of the community, it's a three-year rotating basis, it still remains in 2021, both in database form and map visual form. And then, of course, the database attached, the crew has had some training to be able to go in there and manipulate data as they're in the field. Mm-hmm. So they can use your smartphone and indicate that they're flushing a hydrant and that there is a failed component or that it's in good condition or whatever it might be. And so they can note that in there for follow-up and for better informational needs if you're looking to begin hydrant replacement or valve replacement on a system. You can try to budget based upon the conditions that are noted and categorized in the database. If that makes sense.
As a former user of the GIS system, I encourage passage of this resolution, as I know it can save time and money when you upgrade to the system. And also, is this hint, this resolution to be some information sharing with the Genesee County Grant Commission?
Yeah, they have set some funds aside to do this on a more limited basis.
Okay.
You know, they're interested in knowing where, of course, the underground lines are, but maybe not as much information as we're interested in having. So if you anticipate they're going to reimburse us maybe 10%, maybe 20% of our project cost for providing them the data that they'd otherwise be paying someone else to get. But there's nothing in writing committing that. I expect they'll do it based upon verbal conversations we've had.
Okay.
But I, you know, don't count on it, but let's hope for, say, 10%.
Thank you.
Anyone else? Looks like we're ready to vote, Madam Clerk.
Pinkston?
Yes.
Root?
Yes.
Kramer?
Yes.
Barber?
Yes.
Gilbert?
No.
Hicks?
Yes.
Krieger?
Yes. Motion passes. This resolution is number 8I. Sewer capacity proposal by Kingston.
Whereas the city owns, operates, and maintains a system of sewer collection line that transfers sewer to the county interceptors located at various locations in and around the community. And whereas the current and future capacity, especially as it pertains to wet weather events, must be known in order to ensure proper pipe sizing and related capacity. And whereas Rowe Professional Services Company has been working with city staff to get flow data on high priority lines and lines with potential for new users in order to determine future needs. And whereas additional analysis of current raw data and potential for new users is required to create the need, if any, for capital improvements. Now therefore be resolved, City of Swartz Creek hereby approves the proposal from Rowe Professional Services Company dated July 26, 2019 in the amount of $6,750 plus a 10% contingency, funds to be appropriated to the Sewer 591 Fund.
Second.
Motion made and seconded. Anyone wish to speak to the motion? No one wishes to speak. We're ready to vote. Madam Clerk.
Root?
Yes.
Kramer?
Yes.
Farmer?
Yes.
Gilbert?
No.
Hicks?
Yes.
Krieger?
Yes.
Paxton?
Yes.
That motion passes. Next resolution is 8J, a resolution to purchase a 4x4 truck and sell the one-ton truck that we have, which is 20 years old.
Clarify that.
I thought maybe you were raising your hand to buy it, sir.
No, no.
This is true.
Whereas the city finds it necessary to replace a 1999 Chevy one-ton pickup truck with a comparable piece of equipment, and whereas the city's purchasing ordinance, Chapter 2, Article 6, Section 2406, provides for and encourages cooperative government purchasing practices, and whereas the Director of Public Services has selected a Ford F-350 4x4 from the State of Michigan vehicle contract, and whereas the 2020 Motor Pool Fund has sufficient funds set aside for this planned equipment replacement. Now, therefore, be it resolved, the City of Swartz Creek approves the purchase of the 2019 Ford Diesel F-350 regular cab 4x4 pickup from Signature Ford in the amount of $38,975 plus associated fees and expenses to be apportioned from the Motor Pool Fund 661. Be it further resolved, the City of Swartz Creek finding the 1999 one-ton truck to be beyond its useful life for the execution of safe and efficient duties, hereby direct and authorize the Director of Public Services to auction this vehicle and related pertinences listed below by means of the bidcorp.com or related public auctioning service. One 1999 Chevy one-ton truck, bid number 1GDKC34J9XF022179.
Second.
Motion is made and seconded. Buy a new truck and sell the old one. Anyone speak to the motion?
Just a question. Is this the...
You really want that truck, don't you?
No. No, just a question. Is this second time we've been using Signature Ford? Is that out?
Yeah, the last truck purchase, they had a little bit out as well.
Okay.
New vehicles, or do we ever purchase used vehicles? Is there any like cost savings?
Used vehicles have been purchased when they're serving a lower priority. I think the administrative truck is a used purchase.
Does this have an aluminum cab?
I don't know the answer to that.
Oh, no, I just wondered.
Because Ford, I believe Ford advertises it as steel. Boxes, I don't know about cab.
Well, they used to, they were making aluminum cab.
No, military grade. Light aluminum.
I just wondered. This one will be used for brush chipping.
Yeah.
But can it be smoked? Yeah.
Yes.
Well, if it's aluminum, it's not going to rust out.
Good point. Any other questions, comments? All right, I believe we're ready to vote on this resolution.
Kramer?
Yes.
Farmer?
Yes.
Gilbert?
Yes.
Hicks?
Yes.
Krieger?
Yes.
Payson?
Yes.
Ritter?
Yes.
Okay, that motion passes. I'm sure the DPW director will be relieved.
Absolutely.
And we are at the end of our business, so we are now open the meeting to the public. If anybody has something they'd like to talk to us about, please press the microphone, tell us who you are, what's on your mind. If not, we will get on to comments by our council members.
There weren't any.
Down here, Mr. Hewitt, you were here not the last time. You got any comments about it for the last 2 minutes?
I just have a question. Just at the beginning, you commented on how nice the flowers look downtown, and I do agree. But I was wondering at what time that gets changed over to fall decorations and who's in charge of the fall decorations. Because we're going to be like, the new streetscaping is going to be done by them, and I feel like it's a great opportunity to like refresh our fall decorations and do something really nice.
The Women's Club does some decorating. They put up the scarecrows, and I don't know what their date is. And I don't know if now with the Jeepers Creekers, if they're planning on something.
Yeah, so the Jeepers Creekers is becoming a fall brand for the whole community. And so I'm trying to see if we have some community promotions funds or DDA assistance to be able to do a lot more extensive fall or Halloween type public decorating. Businesses are being encouraged to actually do Halloween decorating during that festival. That's the 4 weekends. Say that again?
Aren't they having a contest?
Yes, so that's happening. Even with homes and stuff like that, it'd be something where families from other places could drive through Swartz Creek and it would be notable how many businesses or homes actually do fall or Halloween related stuff. So we're probably thinking with fall type decor sometime early September after Labor Day. I mean, September's can be pretty generous sometimes in Michigan, and the flowers may stay up, but summer can continue. But certainly before October, we're looking to do some kind of, you know, synthetic fall type wraps along the fencing around posts and things like that. Women's Club has taken the lead in providing the scarecrows and the other plantings or hay bales and things like that that add that accent. So. We do anticipate having not all features of the streetscape would be installed by September. We'll be substantially complete with what Green Tech can do. Plantings will probably go in maybe mid-September so that they still have enough time to root, but we can rely on a bit more natural hydration for the roots to take. And consumers, it's not scheduled to do their lamp posts until October, unfortunately. So that will slow us down. But I think in the future, we would probably see a Labor Day switch over. Keep the flowers up while they're alive and begin doing a lot more public fall, maybe Halloween type decor.
Right. Mr. Kramer.
Yes. I'd just like to kind of report on the 2020 census. I'm still assembling team for the Big Cup Committee. I do plan on handing out brochures and literature at some of our fall events. And then I'm planning a September workshop for that committee and to come up with some ideas. So that's where I'm at on that.
You guys got a committee together?
I'm still forming one. A few members now, still putting one together. That's all I have. It's been a while.
I'd just like to comment and thank our wonderful police department and Chief Beta. I've seen the officers several times around many parts of our city, including on Bristol Road and downtown, and driving through my subdivision while I was on the porch one evening, and for being at the car show. Very lucky.
Very good.
45 minutes later, no. It really, is unfortunate that this newest building that we're considering is type 5 construction, which is the lowest permitted type of construction. It's, I hope that in the future we can include something that we don't consider type 5. I don't know if it's possible or not, but everything that says permitted by the code, permitted by the code throughout this whole thing, I hope we can review it and come to, there's nothing more scary to me than when someone tells me it meets minimum requirements, especially when it could involve people working in an environment that is less than, I mean, we just had, like I said before, and I'll reiterate, we just went through and expected great things from our townhomes, and we turn around and okay a type 5 construction. And it's like unfortunate, in my opinion, that we didn't hold them to a little bit of a higher standard. It may work out, we'll see, you never know. One thing I forgot to ask Adam is, when you have something like this that's not so permanent, how do you get taxes, I mean, from something like that?
It'll be considered real property on leased land, which isn't uncommon, and taxed based on its value, just like anything else.
And its value isn't a whole lot. So I think I saw on your site 200,000, something like that.
Yeah, which is relatively hefty for the square footage. If you consider a new built home at 1,400 square feet valued at 200,000, this 350-foot unit will be valued about the same, probably more with site improvements. And that tax bill would admire, again, being leased, a real property on leased land that they control.
Okay.
And they'll have to, I'm sure it's in their lease agreement, how they're going to account for that valuation.
I suppose I should be happy that at least they meet the requirements, but it just doesn't sit well with me. I would much rather hold them to a higher standard, and I don't think I would let my child work in that. So, that's all.
Yes, I noticed somebody ran over the street light down there on the corner again.
Was it me?
As I turned the corner and saw it laying there, Metro Police had the truck responsible for it pulled over in a parking lot. So it was a truck, and we do have the ability to have costs recouped on that insurance.
Well, you know, though, that post is awful close to the road right there. Yeah, when you, making a left turn there off of Miller Road, it's hard for some of them. Some vehicles, especially semis and that.
I think it was a right turn from Miller to Morrish.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah. Just close to the road?
Yeah, it is. There's no room there. There's a retaining wall that's right at the end of the sidewalk, so.
Well, so how long is that going to lay there?
Until consumers can replace it.
No, okay.
I don't know that it actually needs to lay there that long. I questioned that today, and I plan to follow up tomorrow. I'm not sure if it has to be there for them to reclaim or report. I'm not. If it doesn't have to be, we'll relocate it.
Yeah.
When it gets repaired or a new one installed, that I can't answer. But certainly I don't see a need to have a pole with cones strewn about.
You're right.
Permanently.
Well,
there.
That's kind of why I brought it up.
Yeah, I agree with that.
You suggesting that they put the street light on top of the retaining wall?
Could do that, yeah.
Instead of in the sidewalk?
Yeah. Just seems like it's really close to the street.
Dr. Pinkston,
Downtown looks great. Can't wait till it's done. I see the open signs in front of Sheriff Funeral Home today. So that's good news. We're moving right along.
Yeah.
Took a while, but it's looking great.
Anything else?
That's it.
I've had a problem with my computer that constantly wanted to upgrade computer programs at most inopportune times, like when we're starting a meeting or when we're ending a meeting, and so I can't turn it off. Last time it took 45 minutes to download the upgrades at the beginning of the meeting, so I couldn't turn it on and use it.
and our city clerk fixed it. So thank you. I've seen videos where you think, you know, I should have but I don't think you did it quite that way, and it behaved itself today. Thank you very much. Is there a motion to
adjourn? I'll make a motion, we adjourn.
Second.
All in favor say yes.
Yes.
Opposed say no. We are adjourned.